right. So, you reject evolution. You reject macroevolution, which says that humans evolved from other animals. But you're also an expert in biochemistry. Just a quick question for you on that. If somebody were to claim that, you know, most biochemists would accept evolution and that this macroevolution is, are you familiar with the word null hypothesis?
Yes.
So would you say that macroevolution is the null hypothesis now and within the scientific community?
Yeah, I think that's a fair statement. And I think if you ask most biochemists, most of them would embrace the evolutionary paradigm in its entirety. You know, I am skeptical about aspects of the evolutionary paradigm, the idea that life could come from non-life, a process called abiogenesis. I'm skeptical of abiogenesis or the origin of life being strictly explicable through naturalistic means. I'm, as you mentioned, skeptical of what would be called macroevolution, but there's other aspects of the evolutionary paradigm I readily accept. So it's not all or nothing, if you will.
Well, one reason why I was asking is, would you say that you're in a very small minority of people with your credentials that reject macroevolution?
I think that's a fair statement.
Okay.
But what I also find as I travel around the country and speak at universities is there's a number of people who have comparable training to me who actually privately will express some level of skepticism and some measure of sympathy for the position I hold, but they're not willing to publicly announce that skepticism, if you will, towards the evolutionary paradigm. But again, I think it is a fair characterization to say that my viewpoint represents a minority viewpoint within the scientific community.
Would you say it's a really tiny minority, too, at that?
That's where I'm not quite sure how to quantify that. Again, because in part, a lot of people who are sympathetic to the idea that maybe there is some kind of design imprint within biochemical systems are not willing to publicly announce it. So it's hard to know what those figures are. But it's not a large minority, if you will.
It reminds me of, I think there was a Young Earth creationist group. One time they made a list of scientists that agreed with them that evolution is not right or whatever. And so they had a list of scientists who signed on to that. And not very many were, you know, biology experts. And then I think it was the NCSE that did, or no, it was, I think, Eugenie Scott's group. They kind of did a play on that where they said it was like Project Steve, and they had all these scientists who were just named Steve, you know, and they had like tons of these scientists that, you know, said they accept evolution. So it was all these Steves versus, you know, a hodgepodge of other scientists who were against evolution. Have you heard of that Project Steve?
Oh, yes, I have.
What do you think of that?
I think it's just simply highlighting that, you know, the reigning paradigm within science is, at least with regard to life's origin and life's history, is the evolutionary paradigm. You know, and I think one way to think about maybe why that is the case is because of the approach that many people take to science itself, which is an approach that is undergirded by methodological naturalism, the idea that whether you believe in God or not, when you approach scientific questions, you approach them as a functional atheist, if you will, where you're not going to evoke the role of a creator or any kind of intelligent agency in accounting for life's origin and life's history. And so by definition, in a sense, if you adopt that viewpoint, then you have really no choice but to try to explain life's origin and life's history through evolutionary means. And I find that a lot of Christians in science embrace a methodological naturalism and embrace it in a very vigorous way.
Well, let me follow up on that. So the way I understand it, science by definition is methodological naturalism. And if you extend that to philosophy, then they call it metaphysical naturalism or philosophical naturalism. But as far as science, I thought there's agreement that all scientists call that methodological naturalism. Is that?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
But the idea behind methodological naturalism versus metaphysical naturalism is in that metaphysical naturalism, you really are thoroughly atheistic in terms of how you approach all aspects of life, whereas a scientist who embraces methodological naturalism may or may not be a metaphysical naturalist, in that some Christians embrace methodological naturalism when it comes to science, but yet every other aspect of their life, I should say, they actually are theists.
Yeah, so the way I understand it, even like when I was a Christian and accepted evolution, I would say that for science, basically, it's methodological naturalism. Basically, we just consider naturalism only because you can't put God in a miracle or a miracle in an equation. But then that's not all of reality. All of reality, there's also a superset of the spiritual world. And so where we part company is, you believe there's a spiritual world, and I say, no, there's just the material world only, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And to be clear, you know, again, I'm a scientist, and I believe that methodological naturalism is a very powerful way to approach the study of nature. So I would not reject methodological naturalism outright, but rather I would adopt what I would call a soft form of methodological naturalism, in that when you begin to study some phenomena in nature, you try to look for naturalistic mechanistic explanations, and only when it looks as if those explanations are not sufficient and that you have other signatures that suggest perhaps the direct involvement of an intelligent agent or a creator, if you will, that at that point you begin to entertain that as a possibility. So, you know, I think methodological naturalism is powerful, and I wouldn't throw it out in its entirety. I just think that it's not entirely sufficient in terms of really studying nature, and particularly when it comes to questions of origins, giving you the full range of latitude in terms of trying to understand the ultimate causation of, let's say, the origin of life.
Okay, so this, I guess that can maybe lead in. How about if I give you a question and you can give me a question? How's that sound?
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay, so I guess my first question will be based on your book.